Space Agenda presents Spacelab.
Dance, little girl, don't you wanna dance?
School Electro freaks out there, welcome back to Spacelab, the Bass Agenda show that takes us back in time to the glory days of the 1980s when boom reigned supreme. 808 beats, Jupiter keyboards, and the sounds of outer space from a galaxy not so far away. I'm your host, Billy Proctor, and on the show today we have West Coast pioneer and master of the 808, Mr. Greg Broussard, also known as the Egyptian Lover. The track you hear booming through your speakers and headphones right now is the classic Egyptian Lover track, Dance, remixed by none other than Spacelab co-host and partner in bass, Mr. Phil Klein, or as he's known in the electro community, the Bass Junkie. So sit back, relax, and enjoy Bass Junkie's Show No Shame remix of Dance. Sexy, ain't it? We'll be right back. Before we get into the topic of the show, I want to chat about something that frustrated me in 2023, the so-called 50th anniversary of hip-hop. Like me, I'm sure listeners were wondering, where's the love for the iconic and inventive sounds of electro and the part that the music played in the development and history of hip-hop? And I think that sidelining represents one of the major problems with the term hip-hop today. When I spoke to Man Parish last year, I'm sure listeners remember electro classics like Hip-Hop Bebop and Boogie Down Bronx, he argued that the term hip-hop has been hijacked by rap. In other words, hip-hop and rap are used interchangeably nowadays so that the inclusive and diverse meaning of hip-hop culture in its original form has privileged the vocal element, rapping, MCing, however you might describe it. Another way to put it, hip-hop is a culture which includes b-boying and b-girling, or breakdancing if you like, DJing, graffiti and MCing or rap. So ultimately, rap is one element of a broader, diverse cultural spectrum. But as scholar Andrew Leach has argued, rap music has become by far the most celebrated expression of hip-hop culture, largely as a result of it being the easiest to market to a mass audience. Where is electro though? And is electro a part of hip-hop culture? Let's ask Bass Junkie, what do you think, Phil?
Yeah, definitely, especially in the 80s it was. I mean, it was all under one umbrella back then, you know? I mean, when I was out buying it, I mean, although in the UK we were calling it a lot of times electro because of the Street Sounds compilation albums, or a lot of us kids were anyway, I think maybe some older heads would know about the hip-hop division more than we did at that time. But, I mean, I knew about hip-hop and I knew about the sound electro that I called, which is the one I preferred anyway, if you're going to go down the drum machine sort of vibe, synthesizer, vocoder sort of thing, which is more strictly electro. But everything sort of came under that umbrella. I mean, you had freestyle music, which was considered electro, the Latin hip-hop, the, you know, all the sorts of different, it was a lot more inclusive. Yeah. Like anything could be put under that. Well, if you know, if you spun it in a set and it could, you know, be danced to, if it was a similar, you know, there was a vibe to it. And like you say, I think a lot of people it kind of seems it's been deliberate to forget that part of hip hop that was the more electronic sound, the more European derivative, you know, from Kraftwerk and such people that has been forgotten and just dismissed maybe as a fad, you know?
Yeah. I mean, I'm sure our listeners, the reason why we do this podcast is we know people who haven't forgot it.
Yeah, cool.
But when I mention it to other people at work in the university and stuff, they're completely as if this thing never happened. Some of them know Planet Rock, of course, but when I talk about the Egyptian Lover and things like that, it's just not there. Although last week someone did call me the Electro Doctor, and I was hoping that will stick at some point. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, you're the Bass Junkie, but I'm just Billy.
Ah, the Electro Doctor's good. I like that.
Billy Proctor, the Electro Doctor. Yeah, I think.
Yeah,
it
works.
Although, but to be honest, it's the community that's got the knowledge, and that's why we're doing this to find out more about the genre that we love. Now, I think that, you know, electro has many musical parents and ancestors. I think Planet Rock by Afrika Bambaataa and the Soul Sonic Force is often viewed as the first electro track, or at least the first electro track that contained rapping. And it blew the gates off the whole rap phenomenon, because those early rap records that were triggered by the success of Rapper's Delight in 1979 were disco-oriented tracks. And the musical foundations for Rapper's Delight, of course, was Chic's disco funk classic Good Times. But because sampling technology didn't exist in 79, the music was played by a backing band, an interpolation rather than sampling. I guess The Breaks by Curtis Blow from 1980 is another example of this intersection between rap and disco. Even the way that rap groups dressed was based in disco fashions. Look at the early images of Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five. They look like members of the Village People. And of course, this was before Run DMC entered the picture with their Adidas tracksuits and shell-toe sneakers. But as Rick Rubin said, Planet Rock changed the whole game. And it's sad to see that the Soul Sonic Force's place in history was not recognised much during the 50th anniversary of hip-hop in 2023. And I think the same goes for the way that the electro sound became an enormous part of hip-hop culture in the early 1980s. And even more confusing considering the impact of West Coast electro on hip-hop. Not only did electro directly lead to what the media dubbed gangster rap, but electro heads will know that Dr. Dre was an original member of the World Class Wrecking Crew, who were contemporaries with the Egyptian Lover. And you were more of a West Coast guy, weren't you, Phil?
Yeah, I mean, don't get me wrong, I loved it all, but I think there was something a bit more mysterious about the West Coast. I think I might have said this before, and that always kind of draws me in. I like that when there's not much information about it. I'm like, who are these guys? What's going on? And, you know, what's it all about? What do they look like? And it was until their album came out, I had no idea. You know, before that, there was just the Daryl Davis wonderful cover art that he used to do for their 12 inches, like Slides and Surgery and Juice. You know, I didn't know what these guys looked like. I didn't know like any of the guys who are mentioned on the back of the record sleeves. You know, they'd always have like crew shout outs for the West Coast scene, I guess, you know, quite small back then. So you'd have like people like Ice-T mentioned on there, the Unknown DJ, LA Dream Team, people like that were mentioned. I guess Chris the Glove, I don't seem to remember his name being mentioned on the back, but who are these people? Then the Breaking movie came out and you could see some of them. You know, you'd see Ice-T, you'd see Chris the Glove, Africa Islam was in there, although he's originally from the East Coast. You know, but World Class Wrecking Crew, who are these guys? And, and then suddenly, you know, I saw a picture of them and they're wearing, you know, all that stuff as well, because the same thing, like coming from that era, you know, dressing up a bit like Prince, you know, and giving that whole performance art part of the to the music, you know, something to look at as well, which is a lot of what was happening back in those days. Like you say, you know, like Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five looking a bit like the Village People. I wouldn't be that harsh. I think they look way better than the Village People.
All right, okay.
they're real, like, fly-looking suits and everything on there. But it was kind of like pimp, but, like, I don't know, maybe like a space pimp look or something, you know, more futuristic than that.
All right, okay.
It looked good, really flamboyant, and I loved it. It was cool. And the same on the West Coast, you know, Ice-T dressing up with those belts and studs and everything on, and, you know, Chris the Glove with the gloves on with the studs on, all those sort of fingerless things that everyone was wearing in the 80s. I remember having a pair of those gloves as well, and, you know, trying to rip off that style. But, you know, that was the thing back then. That was the fashion, and that was what was going with it. And although there was really fly b-boy fashion on the East Coast as well. I mean, there were some really great things that people were wearing back then that wasn't like that, you know. Yeah, I mean, I don't understand why Electro has not been given the love it deserves.
Right.
It seems like this has been a thing that's just been ongoing ever since it kind of really sort of slipped out of public view, or, you know, people thought it had been stopped being made, although it hadn't. There were still people, pockets of resistance around the world, I'd like to call it, people who were still keeping that going, you know, people like Dynamics 2 out of Florida, the Unknown DJ, it was X-Men Project, and, you know, and solo projects out of the West Coast on his Techno Cut label, which was an amalgamation of Techno Hop and Crew Cut, which is Techno Hop being Unknown's label and Crew Cut being Lonzo Williams of the World Class Wrecking Crew's label. You know, they kept it going as well throughout the 80s in the dark times. And there were other labels as well, sort of Miami sort of based labels like Cut It Up Death. And I think they'd started at late 80s, Debonair Records in Florida. Florida had kept it up quite good. And there was Jam City Records out in, I think they were sort of based in California as well, maybe nearer to San Francisco. There are little pockets of resistance around who wouldn't let that genre die. And I salute them, you know, these people kept it going when it was feeling like everyone had moved away from that. And it's a shame, because I always loved that style, which is why I got involved in wanting to make it myself. You know, I didn't want to see it disappear.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it has, thankfully, it's kept going, and, you know.
Paraphrasing AC/DC, we could say, for those about to jam, we salute you. And one of the biggest pockets of resistance, I would say, is the topic of today, Egyptian Lover.
Yeah.
So you know, when Electro dies, it never dies, as you really say, but it seems to be taken over by gangster rap and other types of more sampled rap, like Public Enemy on the East Coast and things like that. I still love that. And before NWA came out with Straight Outta Compton, they came out with an album that I later learned was a bootleg, really.
Yeah.
The first track I heard off that was Panic Zone.
Yeah, and what a track. That's a great one, that is. I mean, I remember buying that. I remember when it came out, and I remember seeing it. And I listened to that in the shop, and I just put it on, and I was just, it's World Class Wrecking Crew. It was World Class Wrecking Crew. And I was like, because I saw Dre on the cover. I read his name involved, and the Arabian Prince was on there, and DJ Yella. And I knew Ice Cube from CIA crew in action. He was on crew cut with his release. I knew who he was. I didn't really, you know that much about him, and later found out he was writing vocals for World Class Wrecking Crew. I think he wrote House Calls and maybe some of the other stuff as well. It was just, I remember flicking through that, and some of it I was like, oh, it's not really my thing. And then that track, and I was like, oh my God, that's brilliant. That's like, that's the sound, you know, that's the stuff I like. That's that West Coast World Class Wrecking Crew sound. And I bought it off the strength of that, you know.
He's called it the worst world-class Wrecking Crew sound, but I think Greg Broussard would call it the Egyptian Lover sound, wouldn't he?
Oh, yeah. I mean, the whole West Coast sound. I mean, the Panic Zone is more a world-class Wrecking Crew, I'd say. It's got that sort of world-class Wrecking Crew feel. They're probably using the Oberheim synthesizer on that. They've got DMX drums in it. That's very world-class Wrecking Crew. Egyptian Lover, when I think of Egyptian Lover, is 808. Although he did use other drum machines, but he's the king of the 808 for sure, you know, king of the beats. Him and his 808 with the little snap sound, that little pulsy thing, which was the trigger out of the back of the 808 that he would put in his tracks, which everyone was like, what is that sound at the time? You know, I remember not knowing what it was for years until later on. I was shown that somebody plugged it in on the 808 and I was like, oh my God, that's what it is. You know, that sound was in his tracks and I was like, that's crazy. You just knew it's Egyptian Lover when you could hear that going in there, rolling along, you know. But yeah, his stuff, different to World Class Wrecking Crew, but definitively West Coast, obviously shaping that whole sound. You know, there's people out there who I would say have a very distinctive West Coast feel. Obviously, Egyptian Lover and World Class Wrecking Crew. The Unknown DJ.
Dave Storrs?
Dave Storrs would be the other one, yeah. So you can just tell the productions there. I mean, Unknown had that reverse clap sound that really sounded kind of like vicious, like shh, you know, that in tracks, you know, Beatronic. I mean, Beatronic's just so good. 808 Beats, you know, Let's Jam, you know, countless others, Breakdown. And then the X-Men stuff he did later was more sample-based. But, you know, Greg's stuff, really, really beautifully recorded. Lovely synth patterns, really sort of kind of dark and moody in places. And, you know, vocoders. I always loved his vocoder stuff the most. Dave Storrs would do a lot of stuff with Chris the Glove. You know, he had, like, interesting arpeggios and good effects, and he'd always do some sort of very funky, like staccato sort of leads in his tracks, and really funky bass lines as well. Like, listen to the bass line in Reckless. I mean, that's just like a 4-bar 303 pattern bass line, which is crazy. It's really, really good, and it's got those really fast like arpeggios going in it and phasing in and out and flanging in there. And, you know, stuff with the vocals he's doing, all that sort of production technique, very Dave Storrs. World Class Wrecking Crew, very heavy on the drums. You know, the DMX, really sort of lots of reverb. Very spacey, very dark as well. That really appealed to me, that sound.
And those beautiful World Class orchestral stabs. To make it easy to move the beat. Now to make everything match, Dr. Dre will add a little scratch. Now the next thing that you hear keyboards is Shakespeare. The Egyptian Lovers started off as a DJ for Roger Clayton's crew Uncle Jam's Army, who took their name from Funkadelic's 1979 album Uncle Jam Wants You, so there's a funk connection straight away. Egyptian Lover became, I would argue, the West Coast version of Grandmaster Flash in a sense, pioneering DJ moves like the triple threat and playing records backwards with his hands, which he still does today, and I've tried to do it, can't do it. Uncle Jam's Army started off as party organisers, often playing to crowds of 10,000 people, which is quite impressive. But then they started to record early tracks, Yes Yes and Dial a Freak being the first, and in 1984, Egyptian Lover releases probably his landmark pioneering track, Egypt, Egypt. Now, here's some uncomfortable news, Phil. It's the 40th anniversary of Egypt, Egypt this year. How old does that make you feel?
Very old. Yeah, we're all getting very old, aren't we? Life is flying by.
It is, yeah. And do you remember when you first heard Egypt, Egypt? It was on Street Sounds Electro 5, for sure. And do you remember the impact that it had on you?
Yeah, I remember hearing it because I religiously bought all those compilations. So they were my gateway, as I've mentioned before, into hip-hop, electro music. I immediately loved it. It was just a really different track on that album as well. I seem to remember there wasn't much, I don't think there was that much like sort of that sort of sounding electro on that album. I think it also was on the New York versus LA Beats as well, which came out a little bit later. And yeah, I mean, it was one of those ones that whenever it came on, I'd always be, yeah, this is more my stuff, you know. I didn't pick it up on 12 at the time because being a young kid at that time, I didn't have loads of money to spend on imports. So my treks to Groove Records in London would be whenever I could get some money together and a friend to come with me, we'd go up and buy records. And I already had that on a compilation, you know, and probably by the time I got down there wasn't any copies left of it. I would buy whatever I'd been recording off the radio Mike Allen's Capital Radio show, where he'd be playing all the latest stuff, and you'd have the Groove Records chart. So I would go down with a list of stuff that I didn't have yet, or it wasn't on a Street Sounds compilation or anything, and I'd look for those titles because I'd just try and grab what I could, you know. So I didn't have that. I think the first Egyptian Lover record I bought was Dance, the 12-inch of that. I got that, and I got the album. I remember getting On the Nile. I bought that from Groove as well. Both of those. That's when I started buying Egypt's actual records. So, yeah, it was Dance, On the Nile, and Jamie Jupiter, Computer Power. I remember getting that around a similar sort of time as well.
Yeah.
But I just, yeah, after that, I was buying whatever I could get of his, you know.
So, I mean, Egyptian Lover releases three albums in the 80s, On the Nile, 84, One Track Mind, 86, which is my favourite, Filthy, 1988, which I've never, ever had a copy of, never been...
Oh, really? It's hard to get that one now, actually. It has Planet E on it, which is great. Oh, right. Yeah, Planet E, which is the go-to one for me on that album.
And even though old school electro was overtaken by gangster rap and sampled hip-hop, the Egyptian Lover continued to release albums into the 1990s. One thing I said last episode is that we don't do contemporary electro on Space Lab. That's Andy Barton's Bass Agenda show. We're all about the old school here. But I spoke too soon. The Egyptian Lover is not only alive and well, but continues to make music, releases albums and 12 inches. Essentially, the Egyptian Lover is the bridge between old and new schools of electro hip hop. We could say the same of Cosmo D of Nucleus, who we hope to get onto Space Lab very soon. So one of the things I've noticed about these West Coast pioneers, Phil, is that when you come to record labels like McCola and Crew Cut and Techno Cut and all of that, these are independent record labels, right? So Egyptian Lover started Egyptian Empire, I believe, in the 84 when he released Egypt Egypt.
Yeah, so McCola was the umbrella label. They were a pressing plant, I think, and a distributor. They did the whole thing. So basically, I think Greg was one of the first, actually. Freakbeat was Uncle Jam's Army's label. Did Yes, Yes, Yes with Dial a Freak, and then they did What's Your Sign, and Naughty Boy was the second 12, and then there was a third 12 as well. There was like one called The Roaches on the Wall. That was by the California Cat Crew or something like that. That's quite an interesting track. It's just drums with a sample being played going, the roach is on the wall. That's all it says. It's just like this kind of really kind of crazy beat. So I think they were the first ones to go to McCola. Definitely the first sort of hip-hop people, I'm pretty sure on this. And utilise that whole pressing plant distribution network and putting a label together, you know, making their own label and putting the music out. I think World Class Wrecking Crew came next. I could be wrong, but there was a timeline. We could ask people about this, but that's where everyone went after that. You know, loads of labels sprung up through McCola. There was also JDC, which is another one, which is Jim Callan's label, which was putting out people's music as well. They did Nights of the Turntables on JDC. Yeah, McCola was the one, and that was he gave everyone a vehicle to put their music out to the wider audience. So not just playing, shows or something. They could press up vinyl quite quickly, and it would be out in the shops and stores, and they could take some for themselves and sell them out the back of their cars or whatever, I suppose, which is what a lot of people were doing back then. Yeah, and you had Techno Hop started up through McCola, you had Crew Cut, you had Egyptian Empire, you had Freak Beat, like you say. You had Electro Beat, which is the one which David Storrs was involved in, you know, Kid Frost on there, and Ice-T on there as well. There was other labels too, and there were loads of... Oh, of course, Ruthless Records.
Oh, of course, yeah.
Yeah, that's another one. McCola's even getting a mention, I think, in the film. I think they go to the pressing plant there. That's where he meets his new manager there, and it all starts to go wrong for them. Well, right for them, and then they split up over it, but... There was loads of labels all linked to McCola. That was one of the things I would look for when I was looking through the records in Groove or whatever shop I was in at the time, just looking for stuff. And, you know, if I saw McCola on it, I'd like pick that one out, keep it, because I knew, oh, okay, it's West Coast, it's McCola. I know that sound. It's going to be hopefully decent. I mean, McCola even put out some reissued Metroplex stuff, which is one Atkins label.
Oh, really?
So, yeah, I actually had, when I got Technicolor, by Channel One, which is one of my favourite Detroit records of all time, which is the one that Sir Mix-a-Lot samples in Baby Got Back. That was McCola that picked it up and reissued it. You know, they'd licensed it. So, I got that. There was other ones as well. I think they did there was definitely other ones on Mercola as well of Metroplex. So they must have done, you know, a few of his releases. But I remember having that one. That's how I got it first. I missed it when it came out on Metroplex on its original label. I picked it up on the Mercola, which had Metroplex on it as well, but it had Mercola's thing on there. So yeah, that was they were involved in quite a bit of that stuff at the time. And it was one of the companies I used to contact when I used to go tracing back my roots of electro and hip hop, trying to find the tracks that I missed, you know, stuff that I only had on the Street Sounds albums that I didn't have the money to buy at the time. So, you know, I was like, I called up Mercola and they said, yeah, man, we've got lots of that stuff still. Do you want a list?
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
And I said, yeah. And I know you have a fax number. And I was like, yeah, I can get a fax number for you. And they faxed me through this enormous list of stuff. And I was just like, honestly, I was in electro heaven because there's all these tracks on there that I'd been after. You know, I used to go to shops and I'd have a list and there'd be stuff I'd heard had come out and I didn't manage to get, especially from Florida. Was a lot of stuff hard to get, you know, in the UK. But I started going through all the stuff I'd been missing off the compilation albums I had. And I was like, tick, tick, tick. And I was just, they were like $4, you know, these records. They were selling them for next to nothing. And, you know, you had to pay for the shipping and you might get clobbered by the tax man when it came into the country. Sometimes you didn't. I think most of the times I got away with it. They just didn't tax me on it. But, you know, I did definitely get hit once or twice. But, you know, it wasn't too bad. But I was getting these records for so cheap and I was filling out my collection because there was stuff I was missing and there was stuff on those lists as well that I didn't even know. So I thought I'd take a shot. You know, that sounds like something is going to be electro. So I'd pick it up and sometimes it would. Sometimes it wasn't so good, you know. But, I picked up loads of stuff through Mercola that I'd missed.
Yeah, that whole distribution history is really interesting. Thanks for the lesson, Phil. Certainly something that needs to be documented in my book. We hope listeners are enjoying our trip down memory lane. In the next part of the show, we'll hear from the Egyptian lover, of course, and listen to some tracks that cover the 40-plus years of his career. First of all, we have an exclusive peek at the Egyptian lover's forthcoming album, 1987, with the banging track Emotions. Play it loud, play it proud.
I was a little kid, I saw Michael Jackson on TV, and I wanted to be an entertainer like him. But I couldn't sing like Michael Jackson, so... But then when rap came out, I'm like, wait a minute, I can rhyme. I mean, I was already writing rhymes and doing poetry and stuff. I said, I can do that. And then I could be like Michael Jackson. I get on stage and do my thing. So I think when I first heard Rapper's Delight, that's what inspired me to become a rapper. We would bus from the inner city out to the valley. It was like an hour ride. So what they did, they took the black kids and they moved them to white schools to like integrate people. And we were on the bus ride, and Snake Puppy went to my school. He eventually joined LA Dream Team, but he went to my high school, Monroe High School. And he said, this long bus ride, let's see who can make the best mixtape, and we'll play the tape on the boombox for the long ride to school. And so I overheard him say that and said, I could do a mixtape. I could do pause buttons pretty good. I'm pretty sure I can make a mixtape and extend the breakdowns. So that weekend, I was using the tape and waiting for the record to come on again so I could extend the breakdown, waiting for the record to come on again. And then the next hour on the radio and extend the breakdown. And my brother walked in like 4 hours later, like, you still doing that same song? I'm like, yeah, it only plays once an hour. He says, why don't you go down to the record store and buy the 45? And I was like, damn, that's a great idea. I gathered all my pennies and quarters and nickels and dimes and everything I had. I probably had about $6. Went down there and bought 6 45s, and man, I made the best mixtape. It was 79, so it was Rapper's Delight for sure, but I only had the 45, so it wasn't the long version. Rapper's Delight, but I taped it on the radio, so I still had the long version. Barcaze, Rick James, a lot of funk stuff. And I was extending the beginning, extending the breakdowns. Had it going like that. And then when I went to school, somebody said, everybody agreed my tape was the best tape. So Snake Puppet was like, I'm not even going to play my tape. He threw us away. He got the best tape. And one of the girls said, will you sell one? I'm like, well, I don't know. The tape cost me, what, 50 cents to a dollar to buy? I'm like, my time. She's like, give you $5 for it. I'm like, sure. Let me copy it, and I'll bring the tape tomorrow. And somebody said, I want one, too. And somebody said, I want one, too. So the next day, I sold 5 tapes. Yeah. And one girl said, can you put more rap on it? I'm like, there is no more rap. She said, can you make one? I'm like, yeah. And so I went home, and I got Bounce Rock Skate Roll by Von Mason & Crew, and I put a rap to the B-side of that. And, man, that tape starts selling like crazy. I mean, as many as I could bring to school, I would sell them. People were buying them for their friends back at home. Like, I need 3 tapes. I'm like, okay, supply and demand. I got to raise the prices to $10. They start buying them $10 a piece, and I start buying better tapes, you know, like chrome tapes and the nicest cassette tapes. And I started selling those like that, and I started drawing on the tape covers. And, man, it was pretty nice. So I remember one time having at least $1,000 in each pocket. this guy, a grown man, walked up to the buses when we were leaving, going back home. And he started walking straight toward me because somebody told him who I was. And he came up to me and said, "Are you the Egyptian Lover?" And I was scared to death. Like, oh, shit. His daughter must have played the tape and heard all the curse words I was saying and all this bad stuff I was saying. And I'm in trouble. I said, "Yeah." And I put my head down. He says, he put the tape and said, "Can you do this on the tape at my club?" "What are you talking about?" He said, "I give you $1,000. I'm like, "Yeah, I can do it." So I didn't have a car. So I called my uncle and asked him, could he drive me to the club? He said, "Sure." So I said, "Okay, I got to do what's on this tape at the club." So I only had one turntable. I said, "Okay, can I borrow somebody's turntable? Somebody let me borrow their turntable." And I had a Radio Shack mixer that I bought with $1,000. I went to Radio Shack, got me a mixer. I started practicing how to DJ, how to do those edits on the turntable. And I couldn't figure it out. My brother said, "Well, while the right one is playing, like shake it, then make the left one say, shake it right behind it." So you go, shake it, shake it. And then while the left one is playing, bring the right one backwards and then let it go on shake it again. And it'll go three times. So I went, shake it, shake it, shake it. And I'm like, nice. He said, and call it the triple threat. My younger brother taught me how to do it. So, okay. That's a nice tape edit, and I could do that. So I kept learning how to do the triple threat, and trying to start the record over right away so I can actually extend the breakdown and extend the beginning. And so I figured it out, like, okay, I'm ready. I practiced for like 2 weeks. I'm like, okay, I'm ready. I went to the club with my record, bought a bunch of records, went to the club. He says, "Oh, I don't want you to DJ. I want you to do the rap." I'm like, oh, damn, that's easy. So I went up there, did the rap, and got the $1,000. And my uncle's like, "Wow, that was easy money. 5 minutes, $1,000. Not bad." And so I went home, like, I started making mixtapes, DJing now by scratching and killing the record out loud and doing all kind of stuff like that. And the tapes start sounding even faster. And I'm like, damn, these tapes are really going fast. But DJing wasn't really popular back then. It was just something that I knew what I was doing, but nobody else knew what I was doing. And then one day, Snake Puppy and I was in the mall, and Roger Clayton came walking down the mall passing out flyers. And Snake Puppy said, "Hey, man, you guys got the best dance crew, but you don't have the best DJ." And Roger said, "Are you a DJ?" I said, "No, my boy here, Egyptian Lover." He said, "Egypt, you a DJ?" He knew me from the dances by dancing. He didn't know I was a DJ. He said, "You can DJ?" I was like, "Yeah, I'm pretty good. I can do stuff that your DJs can't do." And he was like, "Yeah, right." And so I drove with Roger to the radio station to make the commercial. And while I was making the commercial, I was just going ticka 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 pow on the turntable, because they had a Technique turntable. I never touched the Technique before. Thing is really powerful and strong, so I was just taking the beginning of zap, ticka 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 pow. I was like, "What's that?" I said, "It's called scratching." He's like, "What the hell is scratching?" I'm like, "It's cueing the record out loud." He says, "All right, put that in the commercial. Ticka 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 pow. Uncle Jam's Army this weekend at Long Beach Holiday." And I was like, "Damn!" So everybody heard the scratching on the commercial, like, "What the fuck is that?" I think I heard the word scratching from, it might have been Grandmaster Flash on the Wheels of Steel 12-inch, and I heard somebody scratching on that. Yeah. So I knew the word scratching was just killing the record out loud, but I knew they called it scratching. And so I asked one of the Uncle Jam Army DJs, could he scratch? He said, "No, yeah, that's old. We don't do that anymore." He had no idea what scratching was. He thought scratching was scatting. He didn't know what scratching was. He thought I was talking about scatting. So when I got on the turntables, actually, Roger said it's going to be a DJ contest. And I'm like, damn, he put me on the spot right away. A DJ contest, and it was probably like 6 or 7 DJs there. And they said for me to go first. Probably 100 people in the club already. The doors had just opened. And he said, "You go first." And one of the guys gave me Aretha Franklin, "Jump to It." I had never heard this record before, but I knew that Aretha Franklin was not a club artist. She's not gonna bump this club. Not like Tom Tom Club or Genius of Love or something like that, or Grandma's Flash is Nasty or something like that. I'm like, wow, they're giving me this. I never heard it before. So I put in the headphones and she sung a cappella, "Jump, jump, jump to it." I'm like, okay, that's not really good. And then the beat came in and the drums only went for like 1 or 2 bars. And then the bass line came in right away. I'm like, wow, I got to spin this back fast in order to keep that beat going. I said, I probably can do it because it only spins around 2 or 3 times. I can spin it back real fast 3 times and catch the beginning. I said, oh, it back so fast that I went back to the jump to it, so I scratched that. So in my headphones, I'm thinking of how I'm going to mix this record. And so I started the beat, boom, jump, jump. And then the bass line came in. I scratched a jump, jump, chicka, jump, jump. And I went back to the beat, boom, boom. Then the bass line came in. I went jump, jump, chicka, jump, jump. And put the beat back on again. And everybody stopped dancing and everybody started watching me. They were standing up on tables and chairs and everybody was just gathered around just watching and nobody dancing. So when I finally looked up and nobody was dancing, I was like, damn, I fucked up. I don't have them dancing. They're just watching, but they're watching in amazement. And then Roger ran to the DJ booth. He was up front of the door. He ran to the DJ booth and said, who's DJing? I said, him. It's an Egyptian Lover. He goes, man, you got it going on. Like, what records do you want? I said, Tom Tom Club, Genius of Love, all the Tom Tom Club stuff. He gave me that, and I started killing it on the turntables. And everybody, people was running in from the outdoors, running in to see what was going on. And I'm doing all this mixing and scratching and taking the record going, two turntables, two turntables. And everybody was like, wow, wow. And I was cutting up different parts of different records of all that Genius of Love type stuff. Crowd just was going crazy. And right then and there, all the other DJs walked away from the turntable, the DJ booth, like, he won. Like, there's no use of me even trying to DJ after seeing that. I became Uncle James Army's number one DJ. right out of high school, me and my friends went to this party, a house party. We walked in the house party and looked around, saw a bunch of girls from Monroe. I saw some other girls, and then I saw this one girl sitting in a window pane, real pretty, and she was smoking a joint. I'm like, oh man, I gotta go over there and sit in the window pane with her and smoke a joint. So get me a joint. So my friend went and bought a joint, gave it to me. I'm sitting in the window pane with her, talking to her, but the joint tasted kind of funny. I'm like, hey man, taste this. This don't seem right. And so he tasted it. Said, man, it's dipped. I'm like, what do you mean it's dipped? So I think it's dipped in Sherman or something, or they did something to it. He said, let's get out of here and go home before it kicks in. I'm like, oh man, I think it already kicked in. So we jumped in the car, we go home, and we just sit in the living room, like, man, I feel like real, real funny. So this is probably June or July, and his mother still had Christmas candy sitting on the counter. And I had the munchies bad from whatever I just smoked. So I got a screwdriver and I was chipping out the Christmas candy out the thing, eating it. Then I turned the jar around. I was eating all the glass. Candy was stuck to the glass, and I was chipping the glass out. And I'm like, oh man, I think I'm high. I'm chewing glass. So there was three of us. And one of my friends went home. And then me and the other guy was still there. And he said, man, I'm going to bed. I said, all right, I'm going home too. So I opened the door, and he had a screen door in front of the door. And somebody else opened the screen door. And I looked, and it wasn't my friend that went home. It was somebody else. And he was kind of short. Looked like Prince, but he had a beard like the Shah of Iran. And right at that time, the Shah of Iran was real popular. He had a beard, a long white and black beard like Shah of Iran, but he had like Prince style eyes and clothes and a mixture of clothes, like Prince and Shah kind of clothes, like just stuff just on him. And I'm like, whoa. I wasn't scared, but I was like, who the hell is this? And so I walked past him, and I started walking. I lived right down the street, so I started walking down the street, and he started talking to me. He said, Egyptian Lover. And I'm like, whoa, he knows my name. He says, you're going to make a song called Beast Beats, and everybody's going to know your name. And I'm like, damn. He says, you're going to be very famous. And then I got to my house, and I went in the gate and closed it real fast. When I closed the gate, he disappeared. And that was in 1981. So fast forward to 1983, I did Dollar Freaking Yes, Yes, Yes. The beats on Yes, Yes, Yes were just really busy. And everybody loved it in the studio. I mean, people was walking by, like Quincy Jones walked by the studio and said, damn, who programmed that beat? Like he did, like, that's different. And everybody's like, oh man, that's Quincy Jones. I had no idea who he was. Like, oh man, that's Quincy Jones. He said, your beats was good. That means they're good. So I went home and I just changed the whole beat up on the 808 and made something called Beast Beats with nothing but busy beats and different kind of beats and fast beats with slow, you know, kicks, but fast rim shots and hi-hats, like what they have today, the trap music. But it was at 128, all kind of beats like this. And I wrote the song called Beast Beats to it. I was ready to go to studio. So this is now, it's 1984. And I totally forgot about the conversation, whatever. And I go into the house, and my mother and sister was in there, and they said, where you going? I said, I'm going to the studio, do my solo project. He said, yeah, what's the name of the song? I said, Beast Beats. And he said, you shouldn't play with the devil like that. And right then, it all came back to me like, oh, that vision, that thing I saw. I'm selling my soul if I do beats, like, oh, shit. So I get in the car, and I'm like, and thinking, the friend is driving me to the studio. He's like, what's going on, man? You don't look right. I'm like, I got to think about something. He's like, oh, okay, you're getting ready for studio. I'm like, oh, man. So I'm thinking to my head, what the hell? I already paid for the studio. I don't want to lose my money. I'm like, man, so I gotta change these beats. So when I got to the studio, they plugged in all the beats, and I started changing them up, making them different. They accidentally plugged in the accent on the 808, and I heard that. I'm like, oh wow, what's that? It's coming from your drum machine. I'm like, it's not coming from my drum machine. And so we found out it was coming from my drum machine, and I programmed the accent and made that, da 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 da. And then I started just doing the beat to that, and I finished the beat. But the arrangement was still on the 808. So I kept the arrangement the way it was changed up to one beat to another beat to another beat to another beat. I kept the arrangement, but with different beats. And so I played the arrangement from these beats, but all the beats were changed up. So, and then when I was in the studio doing the vocals, I didn't do the Beast Beat vocals. I just put them away. And I took different songs, like the best part of this song, the best part of this song, the best part of this song, and did Ease of Egypt. So if you listen to Ease of Egypt, all the words are three different songs. So the engineer said, they don't match. I'm like, yeah, it's like a greatest hits of songs I never put out. But I know the songs because I wrote them, but I never put them out. But this is my greatest hits. This verse, this vocoder part, this breathing. So I put all that together from like 4 or 5 different songs and made Each of Egypt. He says, it don't match, but I said, it's a DJ song. It's not supposed to match. It's all different. And we didn't know if it was going to do good or bad or whatever. But man, when we first played it, I first played it at K-Day. They said, when is this record coming out? I said, well, it's coming out in about another 6 months because Dollar Freak just came out and I got to wait. So don't kill Dollar Freak. And they was waiting, it was waiting. As soon as the day it came out, I had the vinyl already pressed up. I brought it to K-Day. And man, when they played it, they never stopped. And at that moment, I knew, wow, this is a good record.
All night. That's right. So freaking.
That beat, and then I heard Planet Rock, like, oh damn, they beat me to it. They did a rap to the beat, but they made the beat a little more funkier. Then it's more bass in it, so now it's more urban, it's more black, it got a little funk to it. So when I went to the studio, I told my engineer I wanted this Numbers track that sound like Planet Rock. He said, I can make it sound better. And I'm like, what, better than Planet Rock? He said, yeah. I said, okay. So he EQ'd the kick for a long time, EQ'd the snare for a long time, EQ'd everything for us, because he was getting paid about an hour. So he just taking time and EQing the hell out of this 808. And when he finished, it was like, damn, it does sound better than Planet Rock. Like, fuck, this 808 is booming.
Yeah,
and on the breakdown, we did the kick drum with a tom on top of it and made it sound even more like doom. So it was too much bass. So when we took the mastering, we took a little bit of the bass out, and he extended the grooves on the record, like going from one song to another song. He extended the grooves so the bass can fit in the record. The first time we did it, the needle flew off the record. We did it again, he extended the grooves, and it fit. He said, this is the first record that has bass like that. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
I like the girls.
Day. So I started in a studio called Wizard, and then I went to Rusk, and I used Rusk many years, and then I started finding out about different studios, and then like somebody told me that Prince was using Sunset Sound, so I booked Sunset Sound. And then I found this one guy named Ellis who had a company to find studios. I'm like, oh shit, really? So it was called Studio Referral Service, and so I called him and says, I need a big studio that I could be comfortable and invite some friends in, you know, some girls. And he said, okay, what's your budget? I said, no budget. He said, okay, we got one for $1,000 an hour. I said, okay, my budget is $200 an hour. $200 an hour, you can have this, and this. These are big studios. I said, all right, cool. Man, those studios were huge. I was like, okay, this is too big. I need a smaller studio with more gear and boom, a lot of bass. So then he told me about all the studios that have like bass and bottom and what kind of mixing board I like. I said, well, I like this studio and this studio and this studio. He said, all those have SSL boards. So I started going to those studios, and I went to Skip Saylor, which was great. I stayed with him for many years. And then I started using just random different studios. I'll go to Guitar Center like the day before and just buy a keyboard, random keyboard, and bring it in and just listen to it. Because when you listen to it for the first time and you hear a sound for the first time, you have an idea of where it goes and how to play it. I would get those ideas in the studio while we're creating and then just lay it down. So like Night After Night I Cry, I heard those songs, the sounds for the first time, and we used them, you know, on that song at that time. And that's how we made music. So all the creativity, all the creative stuff from all the songs came in the studio. It was nothing made at home first. Wow. Everything came in the studio. Right, I wrote the songs in the studio. While the song was playing, I would write the song. We'll do all the music and everything right there in the studio. We partied all night.
So cute, I love them all. When we party, I really have a ball. The girls got sexy bodies, they turn me on. And when we're nude, we boom all night long. The girls here are also cute. For Egyptian women, there's no substitute.
When I was in Uncle Jam's Army, we had a program. We could only play certain songs certain times of the night. And it fit, it worked. It was 100% perfect. Radio was anything goes. So I had heard somebody named Africa Islam was playing at radio. They said, and he DJs not like you. Like, he didn't copy your style. He has his own style. He's from New York. I said, oh, good. I get to see somebody that's not me, a clone of me. So I went to radio and I saw him DJ. I'm like, okay, that's totally a different style. I like that. And then he saw me DJ. It's like, oh, shit. Like, damn, I've seen a lot of people try to do that. But what you're doing is like, there. I said, yeah, I created this style. It's called a triple threat. My brother created it, and now I'm doing it. This is a thousand threat. I can play records backwards. I said, what? And I played a record backwards. I said, and I got some new stuff. And so I was playing some new songs from Prince, and because we was getting promo copies. And I said, man, your name, Africa Islam, sound like Africa Mambada. He said, yeah, that's my dad. I'm like, what? I said, yeah, I call him my dad. He taught us this, and this. I'm like, man, what kind of drum set did they use? He says, it wasn't a drum set, it was a drum machine. And right then my mind started going like, drum machine? You mean I can do it? I can play the drums. He said, yeah, it's called an 808. I was like, where can I buy one? Do I have to go to New York? He said, no, they have them here at your guitar center. I was there yesterday. So the following day, I went up there and I saw the 808. The store clerk actually helped me program the beat. So I programmed Planet Rock in the 808. Then I started changing the beat up, like adding more kicks and different things and making it sound different. And the store clerk was looking behind me and all around me. And when I turned around, everybody in the store was watching me make this beat. So the clerk turned it up and turned more speakers on. And these are like rock stars. Like they're rock and roll stars. And they're watching me do this beat on this 808. Like, damn. And my mind started clicking again. Like, if they like it and they don't even like this kind of music, then this already sounds like a record. I got to buy this drum machine to make a record. And that's what I did. I asked him how much it was. I think it was like $1,200. I had six. So I went home, asked my mom for $600. Like, I need $600 more. She gave me $600. She gave me another $100 for the tax. I said, oh, yeah, the tax. So I went back to the guitar center and bought one. And I said, you know what? I don't want the brand new one. I want the one I put the beat in. Because that beat was nice. He said, okay. So he switched out the 808s, and I brought that one home. And I programmed the whole thing full of beats. And that Saturday, we had a party at the sports arena. And I played the 808, and man, they loved it. It sounded so good with 10,000 people, and we had over 100 Surround Vegas speakers. It was just amazing. I created the triple threat, so right. Nobody had ever seen that before. So when I did that, people lost their mind. Like, what the hell did he just do? And so I think they had heard Curtis Blow, you know, Grandmaster Flash's record. Maybe some people may have heard it, but they couldn't see it. First time they ever seen somebody doing stuff like that. Man, the party about a year later, I remember we was doing a party at, maybe not even a year, maybe like 6 months later, we're doing a party at a club called Playpen. And me and a guy named Iceberg, so I was teaching how to do the tricks. He turned around and we had an actual bridge behind the DJ booth. So it was like from one side of the club to the other side of the club, there was like a bridge going over the DJ booth. Iceberg turned around and said, "Damn, look at all them DJs up there watching you stealing your smooth." And he screamed out loud, "Don't you motherfuckers have jobs? It's Friday night." Every DJ in LA was up there. Every DJ crew, every DJ, all of them watching me like, how the hell is he doing this? It was the only time they could actually be above me, behind me, looking down on me and seeing what I was doing. And I was playing records backwards and doing triple threats and thousand threats. It was like survival, Bible, 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 Bible. And they were just losing their, DJs were losing their minds. And the crowd was partying. I'm playing Planet Rock backwards and like, wow. It was just amazing. And all these records, mind you, were brand new. It was like, wow, I never heard this record before. Now he's mixing it like this. And I would always mix Prince stuff. And the radio station, one of the DJs came and said, "Man, everybody's requesting this song, but they want to hear it the way you play it at the clubs." So I actually did club mixes for the radio so they can play them the way I play them in the clubs. So they had like in regular rotation, here's Prince, Irresistible by Egyptian Lover. Here's Electric Kingdom by Egyptian Lover. These mixes. So people want to hear the way they heard it at the clubs. They want to hear it that way on the radio. And that's when Greg Mack and them was like, we need more of this club music on the radio. And that's when they start playing more rap on the radio. Ice-T was a person that came into the dance, and he always asked to rap on the mic. And then eventually somebody gave him the mic, and he did a rap on the mic. That was it. We never let anybody rap on the mic. He was probably the only one we ever let rap on the mic. I never rapped on the mic when I was there, even though I was a rapper. That was it. And nobody else was rapping on the mic. I would say stuff on the mic, like rhythmic stuff, like yes, 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 yes. But nobody actually rapped on the mic except for Ice-T. So we had DJs part of our crew, but actually when we started, it was like the first hour, anybody could actually start the first hour. So anybody can get on there and do the first hour from 10 to 11. But then Roger would get on from 12 to 1. And then we had like a Prince set from 1 to 2 in funk. And then from 10 to 11 was anybody. 11 to 12, Roger Clayton. And then 12 to 1 was like the Prince stuff, getting freaky, all the freak kind of music. And then from 1 to 2 was like the up-tempo Planet Rock stuff, and I would just get on that and do it. So it was me, Roger, whoever started the first hour. We had a bunch of different DJs. Bobcat came later on. He started doing a lot of stuff too. And Bobcat was really fast, and yeah, he was just really quick. And then by the time Bobcat came on there, I think me and him probably DJed together for about a year. And then I started doing my records, and I started touring and stuff, so I wasn't around that much anymore. And then Roger got DJ Pooh.
Eyes and that sexy tight white lace.
golden thighs. You're so fine. I know that I shouldn't mention, but your perfect body brings too much tension. Handling you is no problem at all. I'll make you climb the mirrored walls. Come with me for one fantasy night and let the Egyptian lover rock your world right. For I'm the best that ever could be, cause I am the king of ecstasy.
So like Run-DMC, Curtis Blow, Planet Rock, Electric Kingdom, Cybotron, Clear, Pretty Tony out of Miami with Fix It in the Mix. All this was hip-hop to us. This is stuff we're playing at our club. We're playing all hip-hop. And they didn't start calling it Electro till years later when, I guess, the Electro compilation came out. Yeah. So I always heard it was electronic music, electro-hop, techno. I mean, it was called a lot of stuff back then, but now it's pure electro or old school. They call it old school now out here on the West Coast. Breaking came with the electro stuff. We played the newer hip hop stuff early, like from 10 to 11. So like the brand new Run DMC, the brand new, you know, Curtis Blow, play all that early. So they would hear it first at our parties. And that was it. That was the pure hip hop stuff, the slower beat tempo hip hop stuff. And then we'd go, you know, as the night went on, the tempo went higher and higher and higher and higher. And then the last hour was that 128 and up tempo. And that was my style. So I kept that style in my mind thinking, this is the best style for partying. This is going to be my style. I'm using that Kraftwerk and Prince mixed together, make it Egyptian lover style. And then a lot of people in LA start copying that style. And I say, okay, if they're copying it, it must be good. Because I'm copying Prince, and Prince is good. I'm copying Kraftwerk, Kraftwerk is good. So if they're copying me, then I must be good. That's my mindset was like that. So when I heard the Dr. Dre song, the LA Dream Team songs, and all these different songs coming out of LA with the breathing and the beat, I'm like, okay,
yeah. All right.
Yeah.
weeks, what it's all about. We can make a dance like no other. The radiant prince and the Egyptian lover. Radiant prince and the Egyptian lover. The radiant prince and the Egyptian lover. The radiant prince and the Egyptian lover.
Put out everybody's songs on the West Coast. And it was a great idea when it started, but business-wise, I was the only one doing things. So I was the only one reinvesting my money. I was the only one looking at the future. I remember one time a big check came in and everybody got a piece of the money. The next day, these people came in with this video, like We Are the World. It was called Save the Children or something like that. And they had all these celebrities singing. It was just like We Are the World. And the world was blowing up. Like, oh, they want us to put it out? And they said, yeah, all we want is $40,000. I'm like, okay, that's $10,000 from each person. And we about to make millions on this record. And nobody had money. They just got a check the day before. Nobody had money. Okay, so I'm about to get rid of this company. This is not working. I'm the only one making money. I'm the only one saving money. I'm paying all the employees now. And they're supposed to pay a fourth. I'm paying all the employees. Rudy Pardee didn't do something with Arabian Prince. So he took JJ Fad away from him and brought it over to Ruthless. I'm like, man, you just lost a big record because you didn't pay the guy what he wanted. So it was a terrible business decision working with three other guys who weren't business minded. They would just want the money right now. So Rudy Pardee pulled up in a brand new Cadillac. I'm like, oh my goodness, you just spent the money that fast? Look what happened. He said, I didn't know that was going to happen. I said, yeah, but you can't spend your money that fast. You got to reinvest. This is a company. And Alonzo was like, man, I just paid something for my studio in my house. And Unknown's like, I got old bills. It's like, oh man, so none of y'all got any money left. But okay, I'm going to run this whole company by myself. All three of y'all are fired. And I just took it over by myself. They weren't taking care of their business. When the major labels tried to buy me or license or just get me to be on their label, I would show them my books and the income coming in, and they couldn't believe it. They're like, you're an independent record label. How are you getting all this money? Another guy told me, says, if you always have another record coming out, they'll pay you for this record. You're never going to get paid for the last one, but you're going to get paid for the one that's out before this one. So I kept making records to get paid for the records previously before, and it worked. I kept getting paid. But that last record, I know they ain't gonna pay.
Is Egypt your biggest seller?
Definitely the biggest seller. As far as units, yes. But then, you know, nowadays you got internet. So, you know, you never sell out in a record store. It's just sell online. So you can make tons of money online and never ever press any records or put them in any record stores or have any people promoting it or anything. It's just sales. Well, I know it sold well over a million because the stamper can only press 100,000 to 200,000 units. And we broke four stampers. So it was well over a million the first year.
So I heard Egypt as well a couple of times recently. I think you shared, this is a few years back now, it got picked up for a license for an advert, for a commercial. Somebody running through a sports shop, wasn't it? Or something?
Yeah, many times. That was one with Dick's Sporting Goods. They had athletes running through the shop. That was a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
I think that was pre-pandemic.
Yeah, and then I saw it, I heard it also on that really good show about the crack cocaine epidemic in LA. What was it called again? Snowfall, yeah, that was it. Yeah, sorry.
The funny thing, it was in Lucifer, and it was his alarm for his club. Like, so I break into the club, the East Region would play. And it was real funny to me because it was supposed to be Beast Beats. I'm like, okay, it still happened, but differently.
Is there a demo of Beast Beats anywhere? Did you record it onto cassette or anything? Or?
It's all in my mind, and I'll never play it for anybody. Even if I did my movie, I'm not putting Beast Beats on there.
It's jinxed now. It's jinxed now. You can't.
Yeah.
You can't.
Yeah, I suppose so.
Two different ways. So like I was still doing shows out here, and they just called them old school shows. Different people would come to different shows, and like in LA it's just too big. So I would do like four shows on Hollywood Boulevard and four different clubs, and four different crowds would show up. So you might have an old school black crowd, you might have a pop crowd, you might have a Latino crowd, and then you have like a mixed crowd like radio, which is everybody in there, and they just all partying. So it's huge. So the radio may have cut back, but during their mix shows, they would always still play, you know, the East Egypt type stuff. So they knew that it was still popping, but it just wasn't the mainstream anymore. So now the gangster rap became mainstream, and the electro still stayed underground. Rap Magic, Razor Sharp, and actually Rodney O was playing keyboards for me. Yeah, my brother was playing keyboards for me. So we had like a band, and we used to bring all that equipment on tour with us. And one day the airline trashed all the equipment. And when we got to the show, it was like we couldn't even perform because it was just, all the equipment was trashed. I'm like, damn. So the airline came, they paid for all the equipment. And I performed with, I think, a CD or a record. And I'm like, damn, this is much easier. And that's when I changed to back to just performing by myself. And then I started DJing again, like maybe 2004, I started DJing again, and then I really started getting booked for a lot of shows. The DJing thing is really big, and then the way I DJ, it's like even the DJs are watching, like, wow, you know. So the DJing thing, I think, is the biggest thing. Like, I didn't know he was a DJ, and wow, he is a really good DJ. I guess after 94, I did a pyramid. I was more doing stuff in America, like down south. I was booked solid down south for like 4 or 5 years. Like, I couldn't leave that area. Did the greatest hits in 89 because of the party scene down south in Louisiana and surrounding areas. And that's where I was at the whole time.
We'll be right back. more time and move your behind. I wanna make you smile for a little while and give it to you with a little style. Girl, climb the walls and climb them high until you reach the ceiling. Cause Egyptian love is gonna make you cringe just like a Twinkie's feeling.
Back into the studio, and me and Brian Ellis create there on the spot. And it's just, it reminds me of, you know, back in 84, 83, when I was doing it like that. So I'm still going to the same studios, bringing in equipment and just having fun in the studio. I mean, I got so many records. I mean, we just finished 1987. We finished 1988. We're working on 1989. It's like, damn, a lot of songs, lots of songs. I'm working on a jazz album. Working on Brian Ellis' album. I mean, it's just so much music we're doing. I never practiced in my life. Only that first time to learn how to do it. After that, I never had two turntables. So I would go to the parties and actually practice and learn how to do stuff live in front of people. So now I learned how to scratch and play Electric Kingdom into it and bring it in. It's like, okay, now I could do it all day long on every record. I can play a record backwards and on a breakdown and flip it back over. And now I start my parties out with like numbers backwards. And it's really hard because the music, you know, you have to keep it on beat and bringing it in forward. But I can do it. I've been doing it so long, I can do it perfect now.
You've been friends with Egyptian Lover for 20 years or so, right, Phil?
Yeah, it is actually 20 years now. We met at a gig that was his first European booking. It was an event called Stereo Lies. It was in Paris in a casino. And I remember my friend Oliver Way, who's one of the people who run EPM. It was a booking agency more back then, and they had real trouble tracking down Egyptian Lover. They went to lots of people trying to get in touch with him and find out where he was. Lots of dead ends, and eventually got hold of him for this Stereo Lies event. The girl who wanted to put it on really loved her electro, and she had for the first year she had Egyptian Lover headlining. She had Dave Clark playing. She had Keith Tucker, K1 of Aux 88, was there. Myself, DJ Digital, and Keith Tucker had played the night before, the Friday, and Egyptian Lover was on the Saturday, and he wanted to meet Egyptian Lover himself. Obviously, K1 being, you know, an electro head himself, back from those days, you know, he's a Detroit legend himself, you know. And he stayed on, so I met K1, met Egyptian Lover, met Gerald Bowe, who's Jamie Jupiter, who was with him. And you know, we were just like, wow, Egyptian Lover's here, you know, this is crazy. I hadn't heard from him for a while, you know. The last thing I think I heard of Egyptian Lover was it 94? I think it was 94.
Back from the Tomb?
Yeah, I think it was Back from the Tomb, which wasn't even on vinyl. That came out on CD and cassette, I think. And I hadn't even got that till a bit later. I managed to track that down. But yeah, and I was like, they found Egyptian Lover, and I'm playing an Egyptian Lover gig, and I was like, this is going to be crazy, you know what I mean? And it was mad seeing him on stage, you know, with Jamie Jupiter doing their thing and hearing two new tracks as well. They premiered two new tracks on that night, a track called Party and another one, I can't remember the title of it, which became the new 12-inch. When they got back, they released it, and I was in touch with him, and I bought a box or two over here to shift for him, you know, to sell. And we sort of kept in touch ever since then. And I did a remix of Dance, because that was my favorite. I asked him, I just basically came out and asked him. We were backstage and I was a little bit drunk, and I just sort of said, hey, can I remix one of your tracks? And he was just like, okay. And not Egypt, do you want to do Girls? And I said, no, I want to do Dance. He was like, okay, yeah, sure. And so, you know, I got cracking on that when I got home, and eventually that came out on my album a few years later. But I managed to get that released with his endorsement.
Listeners have already heard the Bass Junkie remix of Dance that opened the show. To close out this episode of Spacelab, we have another special treat from our resident Bass Junkie, an Egyptian Lover mega mix, all 9 minutes of it. Where can listeners find this, Phil, on SoundCloud?
My SoundCloud page is Pack Jams, and that's spelled PAK-JAMZ, or Z if you're in America. There's a lot of other ones on there as well. There's some of my tracks on there too, but really I'm going to try and do some more of these because they're a lot of fun. This was the third one I did, and there are four up there. So yeah, if you want to go and check them out, please do. Give them a like.
The women here are also...
Bass Junkie.